Good morning, church family. We're going to sing some Christmas carols this morning. It's Christmas season. Would you please stand to your feet? Let's sing this together.
Hark the herald angels sing, glory to the newborn King. Peace on earth and mercy mild, God and sinners reconciled. Joyful all ye nations rise, join the triumph of the skies. With the angelic hosts proclaim, Christ is born in Bethlehem. Hark, the herald angels sing, glory to
Christ is
Lay at your feet.
so much for singing. You may be seated.
Good morning, church family. My name is Noah Agee, and I am the preteen associate here at First Baptist Church Hendersonville. And this is Grayson Brooks. He is 10 years old, and he goes to Union Elementary, and his parents are Brad and Beth, and he's a fourth grader there. You got some family out there this morning? Where are you at? Wave to us. Wave to us. Yeah, wave to your family. Yeah, we're really excited. Yeah, Grayson, a couple years ago at VBS, he started feeling convicted of sin when Pastor Mark, our children's pastor, was preaching the gospel. And in that moment, he decided to come to his parents and receive Jesus Christ as his Lord and Savior. And now he is obeying Jesus Christ's command to be baptized this morning, and we're here to celebrate that. So, Grayson, who is Jesus to you?
My Lord and Savior.
My Lord and Savior, that's right. Upon your confession of faith and in obedience to what Jesus Christ has commanded, I baptize you, my brother, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Buried with Christ in baptism. Raised to walk in the newness of life.
Got to move the stool. How are y'all doing? Church family, my name is Bo Griswold. This is Trey Beach. He is 25. His mother and father are Summer and Jimmy, and they're actually right there filming. And I think he has some friends. If you're here for Trey's baptism, will you raise your hand for me? I know some of them are here. Well, they drove a long way, and some are online, and so it's good to see you. Trey is, like I said, he's 25. He works at the Volkswagen dealership in Madison, and sadly, a few weeks ago, his grandma passed away. But God is good, and he used that whole death and all of the situation to make you realize that you really wanted a relationship with Jesus Christ. And so he called me, and we went over the gospel, we went over any questions you had, and you said, I really want that. And so Trey, I want to ask you, who is Jesus to you?
My Lord and Savior.
Amen. So it's on that profession of faith that I baptize you, my brother, in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, buried with Christ in baptism, raised to walk in newness of life. All right. You did it. Thank you.
Amen. It's always a joy to celebrate new life in Christ. And I just want to celebrate. I'm grateful for the work of Noah and Bo, some of our younger staff members who are leading well and seeing the Lord do incredible things in their ministry. So I'm just so grateful the Lord's brought our staff here together to serve. And so we're looking forward to another week in our Christmas season. I know you enjoyed this past weekend. We have had a wonderful time with Christmas in the Ville, and we're looking forward to what the Lord wants to do and to enjoying and celebrating the birth of Christ this week. I want to remind you of a few things. Tomorrow night, we have Night of the Nativity out here in the parking lot. There's this beautiful nativity display. We're going to gather around. We're going to sing some Christmas carols. We're going to drink some hot chocolate. There's a petting zoo. It's a simple time, but it's a really special time. At 6:30 tomorrow night, I want to encourage you to jump in there. It's going to be a wonderful 35 degrees. So we'll enjoy that together. Let's bundle up and come sip some hot chocolate and celebrate Jesus. Again, we're looking forward to our Christmas Eve services as well on Saturday. Those are going to be at 2, 3:30, 5 and 6:30. And the 3:30 and 5 are the ones that offer preschool childcare. So just want to remind you of that. That's always a wonderful time. We sing traditional carols. We take the Lord's Supper together. We reflect on Christ. Pastor always spends some time with our kids, and that's just a wonderful time of the year. And then we end with a candlelight service. So I want to encourage you to jump in on that. On Sunday, we'll have one service. service at 10 o'clock with preschool childcare. And so we're just looking forward to that week. I know that y'all are enjoying different parts of your family's Christmas celebration, and I'm so grateful that we get to rejoice in that together. I want to thank you if you're a guest with us. Thanks so much for being here. We're delighted to have you spend some time with us during this season especially, and Pastor and I would love to meet you afterwards. We'd love to get to know you. We'd love to thank you for being here and help you kind of take your next step of connection here at First Baptist. I'm so grateful for the chance to continue worshiping together. I'm going to ask you to join me as we pray and we continue singing to the Lord, seeking the Lord, getting ready to hear from His Word. Lord, I thank you so much that you are kind and faithful in all your ways, and we come to you grateful in this season because you've told us that you're the Word of God, the Son of God, who became flesh and dwelt among us so that we could know you, that we could experience you. And John says that from your fullness, each of us who've come to put our faith in you have experienced grace upon grace. And as we come together, we can just testify to that. Each of us can bring our stories of your grace in our lives. And as we continue to sing to you, I pray that you'd remind us of the work that you've done in us, that you'd shape us by being exposed to who you are. And Lord, we look forward to hearing what you have to say to us as Pastor opens up the Word and proclaims your truth to us. Lord, we want to be set apart for you, and we want to be used by you. And so we pray that this time would be about you and you alone. We say that we love you, and it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Come, thou long expected Jesus, born to set thy people free from our fears and sins. Release us, let us find in thee, Israel's strength and consolation, hope of all the earth thou art, dear desire of every nation, joy of every longing heart. Born thy people to deliver, born a child and yet a king, born to reign in us forever. Now thy gracious kingdom bring, by thine own eternal Spirit rule. Sufficient merit, raise us to thy glorious throne. By thine all sufficient merit, raise us to throne. town of Bethlehem, how still we see the light above thy deep and dreamless sleep. The silent stars go by, yet in thy dark street shine.
Worship. I sure enjoyed the Christmas in the Ville this year, and one of the reasons is because most all of these musicians participated. A lot of the people that help on Sunday mornings in the contemporary services were a part of that, and it was so nice to see all of the generations together. I hope you were able to come to it. If you didn't, I hope you will next year, because it really involves the whole church family, and it's a wonderful, wonderful time last weekend. We've got a mission team, Mike. We've got a mission team out right now, about 10 people, so pray for them. It's a strange time of the year to have a mission trip right before Christmas, but we are partnered. Now, I know you're going to say, "Aw," when I say this, but we're partnered with the Baptist Convention of Hawaii, and somebody had to go. So, it's a time when they're out of school, and so we can have a vacation Bible school with some children at a church there near Pearl Harbor. Pearl City Baptist Church, I believe, is the name of the church. And so we've got 10 of our great Bible school leaders that have gone to teach Bible school this week to children there in on the island of Oahu. And, you know, I know we kind of fantasize Hawaii and see it one way, but if you've been there, you know that when you get off of the tourist area and you kind of get in the other parts, there's a lot of poverty, there's a lot of need, and there's really a lot of darkness in Hawaii. And so we need to help those churches absolutely as much as we can. So I'm glad we've got a partnership over there this week. Pray for them. They'll be back on Friday, I believe. It's their time to come back. Well, take your Bible today and find Luke chapter 2. We're studying in the Gospel of Luke, but we've already covered this back in the summer. We had Christmas in August, and we studied the second chapter, but we've moved on to chapter 6. But I paused in our study for today and next week, and then on January 1st, 2 weeks from today, we'll jump back into the sixth chapter of Luke. But today, we're going to go back to the most familiar of all of the accounts of the Christmas event, the one that Luke records in Luke chapter 2. I'm not going to read all of it. I will read the whole passage on Christmas Eve to the children. I love to do that. And John is going to draw some of the story for the children as I'm telling it. So I'm looking forward to that on Christmas Eve. But today I just want to read part of the story, and then I want to focus a little bit on one statement that's made that maybe we pass over sometimes. I'm beginning in verse 8 of the second chapter of the Gospel of Luke. It says, "In the same region, shepherds were staying out in the fields and keeping watch at night over their flock. Then an angel of the Lord stood before them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, 'Don't be afraid, for look, I proclaim to you good news of great joy, which will be for all the people. Today, a Savior, who is Messiah the Lord, was born for you in the city of David. This will be a sign for you. You will find a baby wrapped snugly in cloth and lying in a feeding trough.' Suddenly there was a multitude of the heavenly host with the angel praising God and saying, 'Glory to God in the highest heaven and peace on earth to people he favors.' When the angels had left them and returned to heaven, the shepherds said to one another, 'Let's go straight to Bethlehem and see what has happened, which the Lord has made known to us.'" Now that's what I want to talk to you about today. Let's go straight to Bethlehem. I want us to go to Bethlehem today. Now, I'm really not talking about the geographical Bethlehem. Did you know that there are 28 of them around the world, 28 different places that are named Bethlehem? There are 18 states in the United States that have a Bethlehem. There's one in Tennessee. Did you know that? It's so small you can't find it on a map. If you look it up, it tells you that it's there, but it's an unincorporated community in Wayne County, Tennessee, kind of in the middle of nowhere. I checked several maps, and no map that I looked at actually had the place, but there's a place that the people themselves there call it Bethlehem, Tennessee. There's a Bethlehem, Arkansas. There's a Bethlehem, Kentucky. There's a Bethlehem, North Carolina. By the way, North Carolina has a drive-through nativity that thousands of people, it's a small community, but thousands of people from that area go to every year to see a recreation of the biblical Bethlehem. There's a Bethlehem, Georgia, very small place, less than 1,000 people, but interestingly, all of the street names are from the Christmas event itself. There's Manger Boulevard, and there's Angel Avenue, and Shepherd's Way, and King's Court, and Joseph's Lane, and Mary Street. All of the different elements of Christmas are the street names of Bethlehem, Georgia. Maybe the most famous Bethlehem in the United States is Bethlehem, Pennsylvania. They really bought into this idea of being the Christmas city. They declared themselves in 1937 to be the Christmas city of America, and they really used that name. And just north of Bethlehem, Pennsylvania, is another little community called Nazareth, Pennsylvania. So they're kind of a couple of biblical names right there together. But this passage isn't talking about any of those places, nor is it talking about Bethlehem, Jamaica, or Bethlehem, Germany, or Bethlehem, Switzerland, or Bethlehem, South Africa. It's not talking about any of those. When the Bible said, "Let's go to Bethlehem," it's talking about Bethlehem in Israel, in biblical Palestine. Today, if you go to Bethlehem, you actually leave Israel because there's a wall that has been built between the Jewish Israel proper and between the Arab area, what's called the West Bank. And so you go through that wall and go into the West Bank to a town of about 25 or 30,000 people. 1 million people a year visit it because of its biblical significance. When you go to Israel, you wouldn't want to go to Israel and not go to Bethlehem, so everyone goes there, but it's really not a huge place. It's on the outskirts of Jerusalem. It's maybe 8 or 10 miles from Jerusalem. It's really close enough that if it were not for the wall that you have to go through, where you're actually going through a checkpoint and a border, if it wasn't for that, you wouldn't even really know that you've gone from Jerusalem to Bethlehem. It just kind of runs together. But he's not talking about I'm not talking today about the geography of this. I'm talking about the spiritual aspect of Bethlehem. That's what I want you to consider today. The Bible said, "Let's go to Bethlehem." So today I want us to go to Bethlehem for a minute. Not geographically, not literally, but I want us spiritually to go to Bethlehem today and consider what we learn about the Lord in this place called Bethlehem. Let's go there today. Now, there are three things that I want to say to you about Bethlehem that I think we learn from Scripture, and then I'll give you a few so whats as we come to the end of the passage. Now, the first thing is that Bethlehem is a place of promise. Bethlehem is a place of promise. Bethlehem, when you go to Bethlehem spiritually, you claim the promises of God. If I took time to go back and show you all the different times that Bethlehem is mentioned in the Bible, the first time it's mentioned is in the book of Genesis, first book of the Bible. Genesis chapter 35, the Bible says that Rachel died. Rachel and Jacob were husband and wife, and when Rachel died, the Bible says in the 35th chapter of Genesis that Jacob buried Rachel in Bethlehem. It's the first time it's ever mentioned. And then it's mentioned several more times. And when we get over to the book of Ruth, Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy, Joshua, Judges, Ruth, when we get to the book of Ruth, there's a beautiful story that happens in Bethlehem. There's a woman named Naomi. She's married to a man that she loves dearly. They have two sons. And because of the hard times of the era when they're living, they decide that they need to leave Bethlehem and go to the land of the Moabites, Moab. While they're in Moab for a season, not only does Naomi's husband die, but both of her sons die. Now, while they were in Moab, both of those boys married two beautiful women. And so when the sons died, Naomi decided that she was going to go back to Bethlehem. She was going to go home. And so she told her daughters-in-law goodbye. She wished them well. She told them to go on with their lives, but that she was going back. And it was there When Ruth made that beautiful statement to Naomi. We often read it at weddings in regard to a husband and wife, but it was actually spoken between a daughter-in-law and a mother-in-law. And Ruth said, "Don't ask me to leave you or to turn back from following after you. Wherever you go, I will go. Wherever you lodge, I will lodge. Your people will be my people. Your God will be my God." And the Bible says that Ruth went back with Naomi to Bethlehem, and when they got there, Ruth met a man named Boaz. And Ruth and Boaz fell in love. It's a great love story. It's better than anything you'll find on the Hallmark Channel. And by the way, I don't even watch the Hallmark Channel anymore. I never did watch it. I don't let my wife watch it anymore. We watch the Great American Channel. It's a whole lot more morally based. And this story is a whole lot better than anything you'd find on that channel. Ruth and Boaz fall in love, and they have a baby, and Obed becomes the grandfather of David. It's just a great, great story. When you get over into Samuel, you read about David as he was getting ready to fight Goliath, and the Bible says that he was tending his father's sheep in Bethlehem. So Bethlehem's a very important place. But the most important thing in the Old Testament is in Micah chapter 5. Now, you might want to turn to that passage with me and let me show you what that passage says. Micah chapter 5, there is a prophetic statement that is given that is very, very important. Everybody needs to know this when it comes to truly understanding Christmas. Micah chapter 5, verse 2 says, "Bethlehem Ephrathah, you are small among the clans of Judah. One will come from you to be ruler over Israel for me." Now listen to this. "His origin is from antiquity, from eternity." That means he's always been. "One will be born in Bethlehem that is has always been." That is a prophetic statement that was made saying that the Messiah, the Christ, the Savior of the world, would be born one day in Bethlehem. Now, you've got to remember that that statement in Micah chapter 5 was made 750 years before the birth of Jesus. Think back 750 years in our history. Our nation didn't exist. 750 years is more than twice the age of our nation. 750 years, generation after generation after generation after generation after generation. How many times do you think that somebody said along the way, "You know that prophecy about the Savior being born in Bethlehem? Somebody missed the boat with that one. Somebody made a mistake. Somebody blew it. Somebody misunderstood." But Jesus being born in Bethlehem is a reminder to us that God keeps his promises, all of his promises. Now, what promises has God made to you that you claim? I have a lot of promises of God that I claim, and I claim them every day. I claim Romans chapter 10, "Whoever calls on the name of the Lord will be saved." I claim John chapter 3, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only son, that whoever believes on him will not perish but have everlasting life." I claim Hebrews chapter 13 and some other passages that say, "I will never leave you or forsake you." I claim Matthew chapter 28 that says, "Lo, I'm with you always, even to the end of the age." I claim John chapter 11 that says, if a man believes in me, even if he dies, he will live again. He will never die, ever. I claim John chapter 14 that says, I go to prepare a place for you, and if I go to prepare a place for you, I'll come again and receive you to myself so that where I am, there you may be also. I claim Proverbs chapter 3, trust in the Lord with all your heart. Don't lean only to the things that you can understand. In all your ways acknowledge him, and he will make your path straight. I claim Philippians chapter 4, my God shall supply all your needs according to his riches and glory in Christ Jesus. I claim Philippians chapter 2, every knee will bow, every tongue will confess to the glory of God the Father that Jesus Christ is Lord. What promises do you need to claim in your life? Bethlehem tells us that what God has promised, God will do. Now, I know there are people who like to say, well, this hasn't happened and that hasn't happened and this is wrong and that's wrong. Listen, God has either already answered his promise, he is in the process of answering his promise, or he will answer his promise. But one thing you can take to the bank is that God answers his promise. And to go to Bethlehem means that you understand, you accept, you believe, you claim the promises of God. Bethlehem is a place where we're reminded God keeps his promises. So to go to Bethlehem spiritually means we claim the promises of God. But there's a second thing. Not only is it a place of promise, but Bethlehem is also a place of potential. It's a place of potential. Now, God saw something in these people in this Christmas event that nobody else saw. I mean, from the beginning, God saw something in Mary. It was going to take a very special young girl to trust when God told her to tell her parents what she was about to have to tell them. For her to believe what God was telling her, it took a very special person, and God saw potential in Mary. God saw potential in Joseph. Joseph wanted to put her away. He wanted to divorce her. Can you imagine how much ribbing he took from his friends when he told them what he told them? When they told people what had been told to them, how Mary became pregnant, can you imagine how much ribbing he must have taken and what people said behind his back? And yet God saw in Joseph a potential that he would be faithful, that he would believe God, that he would obey God and do what he was called to do. God saw potential in them. God saw potential in those shepherds. I mean, they would not have been invited to anybody's dinner party. Nobody saw anything in them except the lowest class, the hardest working, the dirtiest, most unacceptable people of society, and yet God chose to send his message to them because God saw potential in them. God sees potential in you too. Now, you may not see much potential in yourself. You may think you don't have much to offer. But let me tell you something, the Holy Spirit of God has come to live inside of you. And the Bible says in the book of 1 Corinthians that God has gifted you. The Bible says in the book of Romans that God has gifted you. He's given a spiritual gift to you. And there's something that God has for you to do that no one else in this body of Christ can do. God has called you, God has equipped you because God sees a potential in you that you don't even see in yourself. Over in the Gospel of John, when Jesus met this man called Simon, now we call him Simon Peter or Peter usually, but when Jesus met him, this is what the Bible says. When Jesus saw him, he said, "You are Simon, the son of John. You will be called Cephas," which means rock. Now Cephas is an Aramaic word that means rock. The Greek word is Greek, so Cephas and Peter mean the same thing, just two different languages. But Jesus saw something in Simon to the point that he changed his name. You are called Simon, but you will be called the Rock. God sees something in you too. I don't know what his nickname for you would be. I don't know what he might change your name to. I would pray that God would look at us and say, your name will be faithful. Your name will be loyal. Your name will be trustworthy. Your name will be consistent follower of Christ. God sees a potential in you, whether you see it in yourself or not. When you go to Bethlehem, you see the potential. There's a third thing, though. Not only do we see God's promises and we see God's potential, but we see God's plan unfold. We just see the plan unfold. It's an amazing thing. 750 years before, God had said that this Messiah is going to be born in Bethlehem. And 750 years has passed and nothing's happened. And at just the right moment, Herod, who was the ruler over Galilee, became concerned because he remembered. Why did he remember it at this moment? I don't know. But he remembered that there had been talk about a king being born, and he became worried that this king that was going to be born, the king of the Jews, would take his authority. So he went to the religious leaders. If he's going to be king of the Jews, he asked the Jews, where is this king supposed to be born? And the king of the Jews, or the Jews, the religious leaders, they quoted what I quoted just a minute ago out of Micah chapter 5. They said that he's supposed to be born in Bethlehem. Do you see how God's connecting the dots? And it was then that Herod decided that he was going to have all of the baby boys from this age to birth put to death. Now, honestly, when you hear that this child's coming from Bethlehem, you've got to think, well, okay, Joseph and Mary are out of the picture. They're no longer going to be in this Christmas play, this production. They live in Nazareth. That's 90 miles away. She's 9 months pregnant. There's no way that any man in his right mind is going to take his 9-month pregnant wife on a 90-mile journey from Nazareth to Bethlehem. Nobody in their right mind is going to do that. And Mary's not going to do that. She's going to say, you're crazy. You go if you want to. I'm not going. But at just that moment in time, God is connecting the dots. Caesar Augustus issued a decree that all the world would be taxed. And further, he said, you can't just be at home. You can't just go register in Nazareth and be taxed. You've got to go back to your city of origin. So now Joseph has to go to Bethlehem because that's the city of David, his ancestor. Mary and Joseph wouldn't have chosen to do that. They would have never done it at that moment in time, but God was connecting the dots because God has a plan. God has a plan for you too. Jeremiah chapter 29, maybe that's another one of the passages that you claim as a promise. I have a plan for you. I have a purpose for you, and it's to prosper you. It's for your good. You know, God has a plan for you that if you could see all the dots, if you could see what God has planned, God has a plan for you that you would choose if you just knew. But we don't know. Let me tell you something. There'll be times in your life, if you haven't already experienced it, you will experience, where something happens and you see what happens as a problem. It's trouble. But later in your life, you will see how God used that to connect the dots and to put you on a road to fulfill His purpose and His plan in your life. God has a plan, and you can trust Him. Why didn't God send Jesus to Jerusalem? Why wasn't he born in Jerusalem? I mean, that's the religious center of the world. I think he wasn't born in Jerusalem because the hope of the world is not in religion. Had it been in religion, they had religion. The hope of the world is in a relationship that comes through the Savior who came to die on the cross and to be raised again from the dead. Why wasn't Jesus born in Rome? That's the power of the world. That's where the military is. That's where the strength is. Because the hope of the world is not in politics and it's not in military. Well, why wasn't Jesus born in Athens? That's the intellectual, cultural, educational center of the world. Why wasn't he born in Athens? Because the hope of the world is not in education and it's not in culture and it's not in philosophy. The hope of the world is in Christ. And he was born in Bethlehem to fulfill the promise that God had given long ago. Now, what are the so whats? If you're visiting so whats, after I try to exegete a passage, I talk about the history of it, I try to bring it down to what does this mean to us? What are we supposed to do with this? Let me give you just 3 or 4 things real quick. Number one so what is that God still speaks to ordinary people like us. It's amazing to me that God did not send the message to kings and priests. He didn't send it to the high priest. He didn't send it to Herod. He didn't send it to Caesar Augustus. He sent this message to shepherds. They were the lowest class. I don't mean to be offensive with this statement. So please don't take this statement in an offensive way. But when you see someone on the side of the road with a shopping cart, and a sign, and they're looking for some help, And what you may, the thought you may have in your mind, let me tell you that in their world, they looked at shepherds five times worse than that. Shepherds were the lowest class that people could be. Shepherds were dirty. They were unwanted. They were what many people considered to be unnecessary in life. They were in the way. They made people feel uncomfortable. They didn't want to be around them. And it was to those people that God sent this message. God still sends his message to plain, ordinary people like you and you and you and you and me. It's to people like us. Here's a second, so what? We don't have to be afraid of what's going on in this world. Do you remember when when the angel came and told Mary that she was going to have Jesus? First thing the angel said was, don't be afraid. Fear not. Remember when the angel came to Joseph and was trying to tell Joseph, don't put her away, don't divorce her. This is the child that's in her is from the Holy Spirit. The first thing the angel said to Joseph was, don't be afraid. When the angel came to these shepherds out in the field, the first thing the angel said was, don't be afraid. We're living in a day where we say over and over, we say it all the time, I don't know what this world's coming to. We're in a mess. I don't know what life's going to be like for my grandchildren or your children. I don't know what the world's coming to. How can it get any worse? Look, I don't know everything about God. I don't pretend to know everything about God, but I know this. I know God is not sitting in heaven twiddling his thumbs saying, oh no, I didn't see this coming. I didn't know it was going to get this bad. I don't know what to do now. My hands are tied. I'm backed into a corner. Oh me, what am I going to do now? Bless my heart. I don't know what to do. I promise you, God knows what he is going to do, and God has known from the beginning of time. And we don't have any reason to fear because God is on the throne. And he rules and reigns over the affairs of his people. And from the very beginning of time, God has had a plan. And we don't have to be afraid. The third thing, and this is very important, the third thing, the so what, that I want you to see is that I find it very interesting the way the shepherds went to Bethlehem. Now, if you'll go back and read it, and I won't take time to do it right now, but you read it later, and what you'll see is that they're never told to go to Bethlehem. What the angel says is, for unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior who is Christ the Lord. And then the angel does say, you would find the baby, or you will find the baby. In other words, if you go to Bethlehem, you will find the babe wrapped in snug clothing, lying in a feeding trough. But they had to decide whether they were going to go to Bethlehem or not. Now, I've always just assumed, this is kind of a new thought to me, and I'm 65 years old, and this is a new thought to me. I just kind of always assumed that the angel showed up to this group of shepherds, and every one of them said, well, boys, let's go. Giddy up. Don't you imagine that some of the shepherds said, I'm not going to Bethlehem. I've got sheep to watch. I'm not leaving the sheep for wolves or for somebody to come and steal or for them to wander off. You go to Bethlehem if you want to. I'm not going to Bethlehem. I wonder how many shepherds stayed back and how many shepherds went. You know what it reminds me of? This is the so what. Everybody's got a decision to make. Everybody's got a decision to make. Are you going to believe God? Are you going to follow God? Are you going to trust God? Are you going to obey God? Are you going to go to Bethlehem or not? He calls and you respond or you reject. They said, let's go to Bethlehem. And I say to you today, let's go to Bethlehem. You know what will happen if we go to Bethlehem? Same thing that happened to the shepherds. He'll change your life. He'll change your life and your life and your life and my life. Because when we go to Bethlehem, when we come to understand that God's promises are true and that there's a great potential locked up inside of us and that God has a plan and we can trust him, when we go to Bethlehem, spiritually, everything changes. So let's go to Bethlehem this Christmas. Let's pray. Father, thank you for the passage that reminds us that we have a choice to make. It's a decision. You've called. The Holy Spirit knocks on our heart's door. we have available to us truth that will set us free. And sometimes in our lives, Lord, the reality is that you call and we're like the innkeeper and we're a little busy and preoccupied. And in our heart at that moment, there's just no room. There's no vacancy. And when that happens, we miss the blessing that you have for us. So, Lord, I pray today that none of us would be so busy, so preoccupied, that there would be no room in the end of our heart for you. And I pray that spiritually, right now, that we would go to Bethlehem, that we would claim your promises and see that you have faith in us. You have put a potential in us that's greater than anything we could imagine, and that we can trust your plan. We see it as a problem, but in the final analysis, it's just all a part of your plan. Help us to trust you, Lord, as we go to Bethlehem today. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's stand together. We're going to worship again. Ben or Bo, Brett, Ben, somebody's going to be here with me. And if the Lord leads you, you can come to the altar and pray. You can come and share, talk with one of us. We want to help you any way we can. But let's worship him right now as we sing.
Forgiveness was born with the pleasure. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's
Thank y'all for being here in worship this morning.